34. Let's all stand and turn to number 534.
I'll live for Jesus. Father, we just give thanks today to be in your house, just listen to your music, just to lift our spirits up. Be with those that are not here today and those that are on Facebook. Just let them listen to the words that the pastor has been given today. Just use him to be your voice for the church. Just encourage the rest of us to go our day and always find a way to glorify you and to honor you. Let this church be a blessing to those around, and just listen to your word in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. How's the antibiotic going? Okay, so maybe no skin thing. Okay, all right. Little man has a rash. They've been trying to figure out what it is, and so if it doesn't get cleared up, he's going to have a biopsy on Friday. Not a skin scraping, but where they just take a little plug of skin out. And so let's pray that the antibiotic continues to work there. As we go through the prayer request, we always have unspoken prayer requests. I do have a praise here when we pray for, God created us to have a special relationship with us. So we usually pray for man in three different ways. We pray for the leading saints and the laboring saints. And I want you to know that, if you don't, I think everybody present knows, but in case you missed it, Damaris did get her visa yesterday, so she will be able to go to school. Doug is still on deployment, and his son had a couple of faux pas last night. If y'all didn't see his big long messages today, he left his keys and his wallet in a car while he was traveling, and someone relieved him. I said son.
I didn't hear you say son. I'm sorry.
Yeah, Doug's son had a great faux pas last night. He left the keys and the wallet in the car, and he lost it all. Somebody relieved him of it, and so he had to pray for that situation there. We're praying for Alex, Doug's wife's brother, for salvation and total surrender to the Lord. Still praying for the church to have the boldness to witness and the wisdom as to how. Praying for, Fred's nephew, who basically has some discipline issues. And Fred is stateside right now. I'm still praying for these college-age kids. I know they think they're grown, but we still think they're kids. Amen. We have a list of lagging saints and lost souls for which we are praying. Pray for Heritage. I'm very excited about Sunday's sermon. We will be moving into chapter 3 of 2 Corinthians. If you would pray, I believe that I think that the theme of 2 Corinthians chapter 3 is God is our sufficiency. But based on what I see happening in society and what I see in that chapter, I think we're going to title the sermon, It's Time to Pick a Side. Time to Pick a Side. So you be in prayer about that. Pray for our sister churches and our missionaries. Speaking of missionaries, not one that we support, but Carol Shaw has, he just sent me the thing, I think 7 more treatments, and she has a spot, the radiation has caused a tender spot, so they have given her some kind of ointment, but let's pray that doesn't turn into a problem. You know, radiation, we do cook with radiation, if y'all don't realize that. So Tom Lancaster is in the middle of his radiation, right?
They've not started it yet. They're giving him hormones and then I think to deplete testosterone, and then they're starting the radiation next week, maybe?
To deplete testosterone. This is an 80-year-old Marine right there, amen. Anyway, let's pray for him. My buddy Randy Rigdon is a Vietnam era vet. I don't know if he actually went to Vietnam or not, but I know he jumped out of planes. He had a valve replacement here a couple of weeks ago, and he's coming back leaps and bounds. He's already driving again. And then when he gets to a certain point, he has to have, be it chemo or radiation, he has to have prostate cancer treatment. So let's continue to pray for him. see, there was one other one immediately. So we always try to pray for our active duty and reservists and the DOD contractors, and there's some craziness going on, all points aforementioned there. Okay, so Landon is the young high school graduate who had the brain tumor, as much of it as they could removed, and he took them a long time to get him awakened, so we want to continue to pray for him. What about your grandma, Abraham?
I haven't heard anything back from her for a few months.
Okay, so should we take her off or continue to pray? You think take her off? Okay. I got a text from Joe right before church started, but I could not read it, and so I'm really not sure where Joe is at. What about your dad's heart thingy?
I've heard that either.
Okay. Chamberlain texted me, and I read part of it. Chamberlain, I know you're listening. She is a lady of many words. And so the gist of it was, because she got it just right before I came to come up here. The gist of it is they're going to tell her tomorrow when, they should tell her tomorrow when they're going to do the cesarean. Is that correct, sir?
We should find out more tomorrow. We
should find out tomorrow. Okay. And so Kira is approaching that date, so we may have two babies in July instead of one in July and one in August. We'll see what the Lord does there. Lorelai is praying that it's either before camp or after camp. How many hours?
For what?
For camp. What? For you? You got your countdown going. Tell us what the countdown is.
It was like 97 hours. No, wait. I don't know. It was either 97 or 92 something hours.
No, you were so firm with it when you walked in. Is it not on your watch?
I don't know what it is now. My watch is wrong.
You said 93 earlier.
93, so like whatever time it is now,
16.
So, yeah.
So they're pretty excited. This one has said, I'm so excited about camp, about 55 times in the last week. And then he's got a countdown app. So let's pray for camp that the Lord
will do. That's just in my
head. Wonders. That's just in your head? I thought you had an app.
No.
Oh, no wonder you couldn't get it straight there.
You don't math in public.
I never math. If I math in public, I get it wrong. That's just the facts of it. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
I would like to give a praise and a prayer request for my little baby sister. She is in her lower 20s. She's 11 years younger than me. So she makes a lot of really bad decisions, but she had, when I talked to her, it acceptable if I wanted to talk about the faith with her. She just doesn't want to go into a house of God because it makes her uncomfortable, but she's open to talking about faith and about scriptures, and I'm hoping to minister to her a little bit over the next few weeks and help bring her closer to Christ.
That falls underneath our praying for the gumption and the gall, the witness and the wisdom as to when and how. Amen. We will pray for that. Anybody else? Leon, are you waving at me or scratching your ear? What are you doing?
I was thinking, this is a homeless guy in Cape Town, and every time I walk into the city, I kind of meet this guy and talk with him a bit, and he already told me that he believes in God, so I'm just praying for him that he gives his life to Christ, and
amen. Do you know this homeless guy's name?
No.
He's not Peter from Poland, is he? Peter from Poland used to live in the woods over here, and he would come over here and charge his phone.
Yeah.
It's not Peter from Poland?
No, I'm not
Peter.
He's like
20 or 30. That's how old this guy was, so anyway. All right.
I see the potential in him.
Okay.
Yeah.
Anybody else?
I would actually like to add
Yes, that is. So different people have told me about their bad things that have gone on this week. How would you like it if you graduated in May and in the middle of July, they say, hey, your final exams have never arrived, and he had to take them all again this week, 6 weeks after he was finished. So, and you can't really, a little stress on him. Oh, still has a couple?
Yeah, it's like his 2 months since he finished, and he still has his two hard ones left. But I'm sending them in. They just need to make sure they're getting them and not coming up with anything else they need to do.
So he can't register for classes yet because this stuff got lost in the mail. So you can pray that goes well. That's a pretty heavy thing. It's probably heavier on Mama than on Nathan, but it's still a heavy thing. Anybody else? All right. Jeremy Adam Coleman, would you pray for us this evening?
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, as we come to you, just Lord, just thank you so much for being able to be here this evening, Lord. Just thank you for John for bringing this message. Lord, all these prayer requests and praises, Lord, we give them to you, Lord. Just thank you so much for the praises and things going well. And just, Lord, just for those that are, for all those things that we're trying to lift up, Lord, I just pray that you'll just intervene and just be with those folks as well. Just thank you so much for just loving us and just consistently being there for us, Lord. Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. So we've been talking about revival for a long time, and when we started this Heavenly Heroes, this Legendary Leaders, this Champion for Christ series, part of our purpose was to show that God can use us, right? And I just want you to, along the lines of a praise, I want you to pay attention to what's going on around you. We've brought out the fact that Louisiana has recently passed, I would assume you would call it a law, but basically the state house has said that every school district has to display the Ten Commandments and have the Bible in its curriculum. Oklahoma has passed a similar law. I think I've told you, but just in the event that I failed to tell you, I think I'm most impressed right now with what the state of Tennessee has done. They passed a resolution, the governor signed it, asking, this has been, what day of the month is it? It is the 19th? 17th. So this is 17 days, they're 17 days into it, but their state government asked the state of Tennessee to spend the month of July in prayer and intermittent fasting for the state of the country and for the direction that it's going. Now, that's a good sign. And then, you know, I have not watched it. Jeremy sent me a link. But I did read after several people who were at the Republican National Convention yesterday, and several people made statements along the lines of, it was like being at church, it was like a testimony service, and those are good signs, okay? So let's continue to pray that way. We've talked about famous people in this Champions for Christ. We have talked about people like last week. I don't think too many people outside the family, the families of the various people from last week, my dad, James Taylor, Jamie Stark, Ralph Tunnell, David Tunnell. I don't think too many people outside their families would know them. It would give me a fit right when I'm ready to do it here. Let's try this. All right, so tonight we're going to talk about Mary Slessor. Mary Slessor was born in 1848, and I'm going to give you a timeline and some stuff about her, but I want to kind of tell you before we get into it that this reminds me of a couple of different things. One thing in particular, when everybody familiar with Hudson Taylor? So two people are familiar with Hudson Taylor. Maybe I need to do Hudson Taylor as a Champion for Christ sometime. Hudson Taylor started the China Inland Mission. Okay, Hudson Taylor dressed Chinese, lived Chinese, won Chinese to Christ. I believe he made a translation of the scripture that the Chinese believers still use. But At any rate, he was instrumental in the founding of the China Inland Mission, if he didn't actually found it himself. He was interviewing a guy for the mission field towards the end of his life there. And the guy had no legs, Phil. So Hudson Taylor said, "Why do you think you should go to the mission field when you don't have legs?" Now, I would ask you to hazard a guess, but I don't think anybody will actually do it. So I'll just tell you, the man's answer was just amazing to me. Because I don't see anybody with two legs going. He was approved. Oftentimes we talk about a call to missions, and I think that's important. I don't mean to disavow a call to missions, but Don Sisk, who's, I don't know, in his 90s maybe, babe?
Yeah.
Don Sisk said, I can't tell you how many times I've... Don Sisk was a missionary to Japan for years and years and years and years. And Don Sisk said, "Why do you need a call when you have a commission? We're given the Great Commission, right? Go ye therefore and teach all nations. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." "Repentance and remission of sins in his name should be preached beginning at Jerusalem. As the Father sent me, so send I you. You shall receive power after that. The Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me." He said, You just go and serve God for the next 20 or 30 years. And if I'm wrong, I think he'll forgive us both. I really don't think that it's wrong to talk about a call to missions. At the same time, I don't think Brother Sisk is wrong. If we have a commission, why do we worry so much about it? I mean, we're 28 weeks. Don't raise your hand. But I want you to really think about this. We are 28 weeks into a 52-week year. How many people have you invited to church? How many people have you sat down with or got on a phone with and asked them if they have any spiritual beliefs? What they believe about Jesus, what they believe about heaven and hell. Where would they go if they die? Were they wrong? Would they want to know? We're halfway through the year. Now, let's talk about this lady. You have to realize, Mary Slessor was born in 1848. Her father was a drunkard. Her mother was a Christian. He was a shoemaker, but he was a drunkard. They moved from one town to another when she was 10. And when she was 11, she began to work in the linen mills because her drunken father had lost his job again. 1848. Slavery was still a thing in a lot of the world. Slavery's still a thing today, though we don't want to admit it. But slavery was still a thing in a lot of the world, and Mary Slessor was known as a servant to the slave when she got there. But as a child, Lorelai, how old are you?
15.
That's the youngest one in the room. 4 years younger than Lorelai, Mary Slessor was working 12 hours a day in a linen mill. And when she got off aid, she furthered her education. She joined, not only did she further her education, which is probably thanks to a church, but she joined a Christian youth club at the local Presbyterian Church. And during that time, she became convinced that God wanted her to serve. She's just 11, 12 years old. That God wanted her to serve on the African mission field. Now, it's hard for us to get a hold of this, Danny, but when she was that age, David Livingston was at the height, we might say, of his career as a missionary. She actually went to the mission field 3 years after David Livingston died. Anybody, besides my wife, can anybody tell me something special about David Livingston's funeral? Can you? You're not my wife. You're thinking, I thought I smelled wood burning. When David Livingston died, they shipped his body back to London, okay? He's buried, if I'm not mistaken, in the Westminster Abbey. But the Africans cut his heart out. They buried his heart there because they said he might be British by birth, but he was African by choice because he spent his life reaching people for Christ. David Livingston died in 1873. In 1876, the United Presbyterian Church sent Mary Slessor to Calabar to be a missionary teacher. Oh, this thing is going to frustrate me. So, Calabar is in Nigeria. And it's kind of white there, but you see all those bodies of water coming into the Atlantic Ocean there. Calabar is there. And she first ministered in Old Town, which is just right, pretty much it's right around where now is an international airport. But then that wasn't good enough for her. There's too many other missionaries here. She had to ask permission. This is a single lady missionary. So she moved out to Town Creek. Now, those of you who have not been to a third world country, it may be just right across the river from the city, but that is very remote even today. So she went from Old Town to Creek Town. And then eventually she moved even further out. All right. Let me show you some pictures of her life, and then we will leave it. When I was reading about her, she stood against social ills, it's true. But everything I read said the first thing she did was give people the gospel. I'm going to tell you about some of the social ills. You can see, I bet you can guess from the pictures there that a lot of it had to do with children. Some of it had to do with ladies. She taught them. She's holding twins. I'll tell you why, in this statue. That's at a big roundabout there. It still stands today, if I'm not mistaken. She was actually called the White Queen of this one particular tribe. Not only did she have this ministry, but she did what you and I are supposed to do. I'm going to go back and tell you some more about the ministry in a second. But she did what you and I are supposed to do. She trained people to take her place when she died. I'm going to leave it there while I go through some other details about her life. And then we're going to get to a scripture, obviously. So, once she moved out to Town Creek and then eventually, Creek Town, and eventually she moved out to live even more remote, she lived with the Africans. She lived as the Africans. The other missionaries, Asia, they thought she was crazy because they all wore either a sun bonnet or a big, broad sun hat. If you go to Africa today and you're friends with an African and you're Caucasian and white like your preacher, they're gonna beg you to stay in the shade. They don't want you to get out because they know that sun is hard on this complexion. But she refused to do that. She lived the same way they lived. The missionaries thought she was crazy because she went, most of the Africans in her day went barefooted. So she went barefooted. Quinine was developed sometime around there. She didn't take quinine because the Africans didn't take quinine. She didn't drink boiled water because the Africans didn't drink boiled water. So she went in 1876. In 1885, her mother and her sister passed. As in, they died. She considered herself from that point forward totally severed from Britain. This statement, heaven is closer to me now than Britain. She was there to serve. At the age of 43, a 25-year-old missionary actually proposed to her while she was on the coast, on sick leave, if you will. They discussed it. They decided if the mission approved for them to get married, that he would go to the rural area with her rather than her moving back to the city. But the missionary board, society, whatever, did not approve. They didn't disapprove the marriage. They disapproved the man leaving his ministry and moving out to the rural area with her. So, marriage is on. She lived her life single, serving God. Again, her main objective there was to give the gospel. She taught the gospel of Christ. She gave the gospel of Christ as clearly as she could to everyone she met, but she also fought for women's rights. She also fought for children. Have you ever heard the term evil? This is my evil twin. Y'all heard somebody say that? Anybody know where that comes from? Witch doctors actually taught, not just in Africa, but in other places around the world, that if you had two babies that were identical, one of them was the evil twin. And they would take that evil twin. Even in the 21st century, when I lived in Burkina Faso, or when we lived in Burkina Faso, I didn't know the gentleman, but other missionaries I was acquainted with knew a man who had a very pocked face. He had holes all in his face. Because when he was a baby, he was a twin, and the witch doctors had told his parents that he was the evil twin. And so at the witch doctor's behest, they took the evil twin and laid him on an anthill and walked away. And his young aunt, about like Lorelai, couldn't handle it. And she waited till dark. That's why he had the scars. And she slipped out there and picked him up and brushed the ants off and ran away to another area and raised him as her own son. He lived, but he was scarred from that. This was a very common practice. That's why you see her holding the twins, because she fought against this practice of euthanizing one of the twins. That's 100 years before this fella had to deal with it. She fought witchcraft. She fought superstition. The slave trade is still going on. And so witchcraft and superstition were rampant. In 1892, because she was, not only did she give the gospel to everybody that would listen, but she was expert at settling quarrels. So the Africans made her vice consul, which is basically a judge in the city of where she lived. I don't know that I can pronounce it. Okoyono, I think. But anyway, in 1905, she was made the vice president of that court. In 1913, she was awarded the Order of St. John of Jerusalem. In 1915, though her health was failing, she stayed in Nigeria until she died from dysentery and fever. And she was buried there, but she was buried much like we would bury a president. She had a national, or a state, we say, funeral. Okay? By the time she died, she was as well known as her hero, David Livingstone. Today, her name is highly regarded, both in her native Scotland. In 1997, she appeared on a 10-pound note. And she's well-known still in Nigeria.
She's often remembered as, I'm probably going to murder this, Obongawan Okeyon, the queen of the white queen of the Okeyon. I already showed you statues have been erected in her honor. Schools and churches have been named after her. The mission field, excuse me, the mission board appreciated her work, but they were baffled by those things where she refused to protect herself against the tribes. She refused to protect herself against the bugs. She refused to do anything that didn't look. That they thought she was crazy, mad, dangerous, her lifestyle. But she fully understood that God's timetable is not our timetable. Apparently, she was famous for this statement, Christ never was in a hurry. Christ never was in a hurry. She had a little patience with missionaries' hesitations. It was the challenge of bringing the gospel to unreached peoples that moved her to approach the mission board in the first place. And she was not about to sit around with other missionaries in the comfort of a coastal town when there were people dying and going to hell everywhere. So this reminds me of Mark chapter 14, if you'll turn there. You all know the story. Jesus prophesied that wherever the gospel shall be preached throughout the whole world, this also that she hath done shall be spoken of for a memorial of her. And that's why you know it, because it's continued to be preached today. But let's start in verse number 3. And being in Bethany, in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at meat, there came a woman having an alabaster box of ointment of spikenard, very precious. And she brake the box and poured it on his head. And there were some that had indignation within themselves and said, why was this waste of the ointment made? For it might have been sold for more than 300 pence. Now bear in mind, that was a year's wage at that time. Okay? So whatever you make, you replace that number when I read it again. It might have been sold for your annual salary and have been given to the poor. And they murmured against her. And Jesus said, let her alone. Why trouble ye her? She hath wrought a good work on me. For ye have the poor with you always. And whensoever ye will, ye may do good. Do them good. But me ye have not always. If you're given to marking in your Bible, I want you to mark the next phrase until you get to the colon. She hath done what she could. She's come aforehand to anoint my body to the burying. Verily I say unto you, wheresoever this gospel shall be preached throughout the whole world, this also that she hath done shall be spoken of her for a memorial of her. There's really not much else to say, other than to ask this question. When you stand before Christ, when I stand before Christ, will he say, he hath done what he could? He hath done what he could. She hath done what she could. She hath done what she could. Is that going to be? Because one thing, if I say something special about Phil, or I say something special about Abe or Joe or Leon or whomever, but what's the Lord going to say? I think we get tied down with, well, you got people right now and have been for the last few years saying, God's done with America. God's done with America. We have nothing but judgment left. That's why I titled my dissertation, God's Not Done, Will You Be the One? The Bible teaches very clearly that he would rather show mercy than pass judgment. And if he left us here, he wants us to be busy about his work. You know, the fruit is not up to me. If the fruit was up to me, we'd need those other chairs that are in the attic tonight. We'd need a new building for Sundays if the fruit was up to me. I don't have any control over the fruit. You don't have any control over the fruit. I don't have any control over the fame of Heritage Baptist Church or of any person within it, including the pastor. But what I do have control over is the faithfulness of John Stuart Hall.
That's right.
What you have control over is the faithfulness of whoever you look in the mirror every day. We all have these poor little me parties. We all think, I'm no different than you. We all think about what we've given up to serve Jesus. So I'm going to have to put my glasses on so I can see these words. But I'm really done. I'm going to sing you a little song, and then we're going to close in prayer. But I want you to really take the words of this song to heart. Because we've got to get past poor little me and try to strive to be faithful. Moreover, if you're born again right now, if you're in the room and you know you're born again, I want you to say amen loudly.
Amen.
Then you are also a servant of God. An older word for servant is steward. It doesn't say, moreover, it is required of stewards that a man be found famous. It doesn't say, moreover, it is required of stewards that a man be found fruitful. It says, moreover, it is required of stewards that a man be found, you said it, faithful. I travel down a lonely road, and no one seemed to care. The burden on my weary back had bowed me to despair. I oft complained to Jesus how folks were treating me, and then I heard him say so tenderly. My feet were also weary upon the Calvary road. The cross became so heavy, I fell beneath the load. Be faithful, weary pilgrim, the morning I can see. Just lift your cross and follow close to me. That's the poor little me verse. Now the bragging verse. I work so hard for Jesus, I often boast and say, I've sacrificed a lot of things to walk the narrow way. I gave up fame and fortune, Lord, I'm worth a lot to thee. And then I heard him gently say to me, help me, Lord. I left the throne of glory and counted it but loss. These hands were nailed in anger upon a cruel cross. But now we'll make the journey with your hands safe in mine. Just lift your cross and follow close behind. Oh Jesus, if I could die on a mission field someday, 'twould be no more than love demands. No less could I repay. No greater love hath mortal man than for his friend to die. These are the tender words of his reply. If just a cup of water I place within your hand, then just a cup of water is all that I'll demand. Lord, if by death to living they can thy glory see, I'll take my cross and follow close to thee.
Amen.
Will you do that? Will you take up your cross and follow him? No matter what difficulty you face, no matter what friends you lose, no matter what people say about you being crazy, if he should die for me, it is simply reasonable that I would live for him. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for those that gathered out here tonight. I pray this simple word about this champion for Christ, Mary Slessor, a woman apparently you chose to live her life single, and yet so faithful. Lord, I pray that we would take from that. Perhaps none of us will go and fight the witch doctor. Perhaps we don't have to stand against the evil twin. But Lord, God, help us stand against abortion. Help us stand against this demonic trans movement. But let it be known of us that we first gave the gospel to every person we met. For it's in Christ's name, for his honor and his glory alone, we do ask. Amen. You are dismissed.